Hey everyone, I'm Aliena and welcome back to my channel. Today, let's talk about how to organize a Figma file. When I started off as a designer, most of my files look something like this. Ta-da! Actually, it can be way worse than this, because usually I paste in a lot of design inspirations from other apps, but this is my first project. It was a small scale project, so it didn't look too bad. But now I learned that there's actually some good ways to organize your files. So today what I'm going to do is I will show you my system by simply reorganizing this file from like 100 years ago. And nowadays I will have this default setup. I will have something like a thumbnail page, a documentation page, an information architecture page, a personas or user journeys page, or latest version prototype page, and then a sandbox page and an archive page. By the way, it's not like for all the project I'll have every single of those page, but it's more like if I want to start off a project, I will first put in those page and try to follow as many information as possible. And if I just don't have something, like let's say if I don't have a persona, that's still very normal. Yeah, but let's just see this old design that I got here. So you can see like I still try my best to organize them by different iterations. But first of all, what I say is that I don't have a thumbnail. A thumbnail is something that will appear here. Once you go back to your Figma file, it will just show what this document is about. So this is how my file looks like without a thumbnail. So the first thing that I'll do today is to teach you how to have the thumbnail page. So I will have a page and I'll name it thumbnail. I'll put it to the first page. And then I will use a frame. A thumbnail's frame is 1600 by 900. I'll fill it with a color. Yep. And I will name it thumbnail. First, I will name my project. I'll make it really large. I'll add the line width. Great. And then I will copy and paste this text box and then give it my name. I will try to make it a regular font and you need to select all of them and then give it a smaller font. So other than my name, I sometimes also put in the date. Right. And then the line height can help you to adjust the line height. And for me, I have one of my small logos, so I already copied it from somewhere else. I'll paste it here. And if you don't have a small logo, you can always design it later. And then on the right, I will just try to use a huge circle to design a look that separates the page a little bit. So I will move this into the file. I will add the color a little bit to make sure they look good. And then on the right side, I will try to give it a status summary. So first I'll create a rectangle with the maximum angle size. So just put in a super large number and it will just automatically be a super nice curved angle. And then I'll give it like a green status bar because this project is already completed. Maybe something like this for now. And then I'll put it, okay, again. And the progress should be completed. I'll put it on top of here, make it white color, and make it a little bit bigger, and make it medium or maybe bold. Yeah. If you scroll to the top, you can find this little alignment thing that helps you quickly to align the text. And ta-da! The thumbnail is done. And once you're done with the design, all you need to do is to click this entire frame, right-click it, and then choose set as thumbnail. So after a few minutes, if you go back to Figma, right here, it will look something like this, which is great. And the great thing about this thumbnail design is that you can use the same template across different design files. So that's the first step. And then what I'm going to do is to organize all the crafts here. So usually after thumbnail, I have pages like persona, documentation, but it's one of my small personal projects. I don't have those, so I just skip those. So the most important thing I want to find is my latest prototype, which is maybe this one. and I will drag it to the second page, and I will rename it. First, give it a little iPhone icon. I already prepared it somewhere, so I just copy and paste it. You can have like a version number for this one. I'll just give it prototype number V1.0. And since I did an iPhone 8 version, I will note that down as well. But the problem I see now is that although I have those screens, I don't have any arrows or documentation or small notes regarding what are these things. So let me show you what I mean. On this page, instead of showing the layout like this, what I will do is to first understand where is the starting point of this entire user flow. And I see that the starting point is here. So I will give it a little triangle here like this. I will double click it, choose this one and press shift. Choose this one so you can choose both angle, and then set the angle curve to a very large thing to make it look like a water drop. Click return and adjust it. It can be large, I don't mind it to be large. Okay, and then I will turn it 180. Perfect. Give it a color. And then give it a text. I will say start. Now what I did here is simply mark down where is the starting point of this entire project. I'm pretty OCD, so let me just adjust the color again. Great. And then I will use lines and text to mark different user flow. So I will move this, group this one, move it up. And then I can use things like line. This is adjust the color. I can just copy the text over here. Great. And then I will copy this entire group to mark different other pages. Now I'll move the other things around as well. From here, I can see that this is one entire user flow. So I will copy these again. But what I will do is I will make this line longer to cover all these pages. And then I will give it a name like add another skin. So if a user flow takes up a large space, I will just move it downward to a separate line like this. And the next thing I will do is to add a little bit of arrow lines to indicate how the things move around. I'll click the drop down here, and I'll choose arrow. And then I'll just draw an arrow between two screens. Please press shift in order to make it straight. I'll add it, the line width to something like 4. Sometimes it might disappear simply because it's being embedded in one of the other frames. So you can just move this arrow up all the way to make sure it appears like this. And that's already good. And I don't know if you like these kind of sharp edge. I personally don't. So the way to change it is to just click this line here and then make it to a rounded little edge. Great. So now I know that once you click the home, it goes to the home page. And then once you click received, it goes to this page. These information are not supposed to show outside the screen. But anyways, it is what it is. So I will press return, and then I will give it a little bit, drag things here to make it more flexible. And I'll put it here, and then adjust these. Okay, and then ta-da. You can also click return and make all the corner to like curve corner by setting it to something like this. And once you have like one or two arrows, you can just copy it to make other things work. If you have like a very complex line to draw, you can press P to use the pen tool and then just draw the curve. I will make it 4 width and then 10, and then I'll give it an arrow. Ta-da! Now just press shift and select all the lines, the arrows. I don't want it to make it too dark, and that's why I will just change the color to something a little bit more settled, like this. Maybe this, whatever. This is fine. Now you have something that's better annotated. Now after this prototype page, I will organize all the other pages. There's a sticker sheet page, so I move this up here. Give it a little icon, like. For sticker sheet, I will put it before prototype because sticker sheet is something that I'll use for a long time. It's not an archive file. And something I see in my sticker sheet is that I have some things that are duplicated and not useful. I'll delete those and I'll just kind of rearrange the look a little bit. I can do better, but not in this video. And then after those, I see that it's just all craps. Like this page is just pure craps. So I will just name it archive. You can find some emoji to represent archive, but for me, I usually use this little box. Archive, great. And then for archive, I will put it underneath the latest prototype. Actually, I'll press prototype. I will add another page by clicking add new page icon, and then I'll just give it a space. This pretty much just created an empty page, but what it does is that it really separated different sections. So it just separated anything that's important from anything that's archived. Ideally, you don't archive file just by throwing things inside. So for example, I see that there is a little bit of flow here. I will move it to a section, and then I'll use things like whatever we have here, this format, to annotate these things that's put into archived. So I'll put it here. Say something like prototype last edited May 2nd, 2020. And then I'll add some notes. The reason I didn't use this version is something here. You can take more notes. And probably I'll use a little bit of smaller font for notes. And here, it's a great spot to note down why you make certain design decisions for design change. And that's also super helpful for other people to understand the project, and also some great asset for your portfolio. Underneath archive, I can see that there are many other pages where there's like different design iterations. I'm not going to put all of these all into this archive page, simply because for many of these design iterations, I've created a separate prototype link, and that link is embedded in some of my user research study document. So that's why I don't want to move things around, because that might change the link and that might mess up some things I did before. And I will just put these pages underneath archive, but I will give it a different name. Like for this one, I will say something like lo-fi prototype V1.0. And since it's also underneath archive, I will just give it like a little arrow to indicate that it's underneath archive. And this is the oldest file, so I'll move it to the bottom. Here I have iteration 2, and I'll rename it to little arrow lo-fi prototype V2.0. Here I have a mockup. I will name it to arrow mockup V1.0. Here I have a mockup for iPhone 10. I will name it to mockup V1.0, but iPhone 10. So if I want to go back and work on this file again, what I will do is after this little empty page, I will create another page and I will name it Sandbox. Sorry, I always need to find emoji from somewhere else, so give me a second. And if I want to make any design changes or design exploration, I will do the design exploration within the Sandbox page. And only when I feel like this design decisions is good to share with other people, I will make it to a separate different page, like prototype V2.0, let's say. But I will start exploring the design within the Sandbox, simply because Sandbox can be messy. You can paste different design variations into the Sandbox page, and it won't confuse other designers. Yeah, and that's pretty much how I organize Figma files these days. I hope you find this video helpful. And as always, thank you so much for watching my video. Don't forget to subscribe, like, and comment, and share with other people. More content's coming up, so stay tuned and see you next time!